guests from far, far away. So originally Dr. Gray Richard is from Argentina. He worked for some time in Chile, in Concepcion. And now look, his affiliation is now in Poland. In fact, he visited us some 2 years ago and delivered another talk 3 floors below, during another seminar. Now he went to Gdańsk. He stays there for half a year. He is now co-working with KCIK, University Gdańska, Politechnika Gdańska. And he'll tell us something about mutually unbiased basis and quantum theory. Something about old results and perhaps some new. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, hello. And thanks for letting me present here my work. So this is about mutually unbiased basis. Mutually unbiased basis are very important in quantum mechanics. For example, they have applications in dense coding, teleportation, entanglement swapping, covariant cloning, quantum state tomography, and maximal entangled states. So let me start with definition. The definition is very simple. Suppose that we have a Hilbert space and we have two orthonormal bases. They are mutually unbiased if and only if this condition is satisfied. And this is very simple to understand and to understand in the geometrical sense, because if we have orthonormal bases and we ask for how to define them in such a way that they are as different as possible, of course, if we have vectors and we ask for vectors as different as possible, they are orthogonal. But in case of bases, we cannot consider orthogonal because there is no single vector orthogonal to a complete basis. So the correct definition of maximally distant basis, orthonormal basis, is the concept of mutually unbiased.
And what is this capital N?
Sorry, this is the dimension of the Hilbert space. Yes.
So we have n vectors in this complex space.
Yes.
Dimensionality of the space.
Yes. For example, in dimension 2, which is the dimension of one qubit, a single qubit in quantum mechanics, we have a maximal number of 3 mutually unbiased bases, which are given by these columns. And very nicely, these are eigenvectors of sigma z. These are eigenvectors of sigma x and eigenvector of sigma y. And these two, this blue and this red basis, are the only mutually unbiased basis that can be shown with our eyes. Because they are real, two real mutually unbiased basis in dimension 2. It's the only example that we can see and we can imagine. Because in dimension 3, there is no pair of real mutually unbiased basis. So from dimension 3 to infinite, it's only our imagination about these geometrical structures, but we cannot have an idea about how do they look. In dimension 2, we can consider the block representation of quantum states. So any quantum state can be defined as a single point in the block sphere. The points in the surface of this sphere correspond to the pure states, and the purity is decreasing until in the center we have the maximal state. And so this is the representation of any density matrix in the coordinates of the block sphere. This is the vector of density Pauli matrices. And mutually unbiased bases in this nice picture are 3 orthogonal lines. So these are the eigenvectors of sigma z, sigma x, and sigma y. Okay, what about the maximal number of mutually unbiased bases? There is an upper bound in any dimension, n, which is n plus 1. And we know that in every prime power dimension, there are exactly n plus 1. So this bound is achieved in every prime power dimension. But in any other dimension, we have no idea about what is the maximal number. We don't know if this maximal bound can be achieved or not. For example, in dimension 6, six is the lowest case, and many words have been done in the last years, and many triplets of Newtonian basis are known, but even four bases cannot be found in dimension six. For example, let me mention two important results. One is that three separable mutually invasive bases cannot be extended to four mutually invasive bases. This is an analytical result. And this is a remarkably important property, because in every prime power dimension, if we start from the maximal number of separable bases, we can extend it to the maximal set of mutually invasive bases.
But what is separable?
In the sense that all the vectors defining the basis are tensor product.
So 2 times 2 is equal 4, or for yes. 2 times 3 equals 6, for dimensions which are products.
Yes, okay.
So let me only emphasize that 6 is the simplest number which is neither prime nor a power of prime. Because of course 2, 3, 5 are primes, and 4 is 2 times 2. And 6 is the first number, which is 2 times 3, which is not a power of prime, and the whole problem starts at 6.
Yes. And another interesting result to remark here is that the four most distant bases has been exhaustively searched, and in all the numerical searches, they seem not to be mutually unbiased. So, if four mutually invasive bases exist, they have to be maximally distant, but numerical exploration here shows that they are not. So, people believe that only three mutually invasive bases exist, dimension three, dimension six, but nobody can find the analytical proof of this fact. So, it's very difficult to prove to disprove the existence of seven mutually invasive bases, even to disprove the existence of four. Okay, now let me show you an application of mutually invasive bases, which is in quantum tomography. Every density matrix in any finite dimension can be expanded in a linear combination of these rank one projectors, where these vectors form a maximal set of mutually invasive bases. And these numbers are probabilities that we can measure in the lab. So if we're in the laboratory and we ask for which is the quantum state, we have to measure these numbers. So to measure in these projectors, we get this number experimentally, we put this number here, and we have immediately the quantum state. This is a very easy way to get the quantum state. And this is a remarkable presentation, because the inversion problem is very simple. So the probabilities, the quantum state as a function of these probabilities, it has a very simple form.
And of course this form is valid only for those cases for which complete set of mutes is known.
Yes, this is possible. For the moment, this is only possible in prime power dimension, and probably this is the only case. But of course, we need the complete set. For example, dimension six, right now we cannot do quantum tomography, because nobody knows if this set exists.
In this way, you cannot do
yes.
it in this way.
Yes, of course. In dimension six, we need seven mutually invasive bases to make the quantum tomography. Otherwise, this information is informationally incomplete. We cannot reconstruct all the density matrices with an incomplete set of mutually invasive bases.
Why is it called tomography? How is it related to real tomography?
I don't know the answer. Why? Sorry.
Okay, in a sense, it's like tomography, it's an idea how to get information about three-dimensional body, but just measure projections, in a sense.
Yes.
And here, again, you have a density matrix, and then you make projections on different, somehow, axes. And from those projections, you want to reconstruct the original density matrix. So for marginals, you have enough of marginals, you can extract back the entire probability distribution. This is the idea. And it's very similar to some of that.
And is it obvious that this is somehow a better or more useful representation than just the simplest one with the single basis and of diagonal elements?
Maybe it's not obvious.
Sorry.
No.
Can you?
Well, I mean, what we find in the textbooks is writing row with the help of only a single basis, but of course in this case there are coherences of diagonal elements appearing in the expansion.
Yes.
Is this representation obviously better or more useful than the standard one?
Yes.
In what way?
In this way. These kind of measurements are optimal in this sense. Given that mutually invasive bases are as much distant as possible, the redundancy of information is minimized. And also the robustness under noise is maximized. Because, of course, if we go to the lab, all these numbers have errors.
Mm-hmm. So the precision of reconstructing the state is best if you use this technique.
Yes. If you consider any other set of n plus one bases, which are not mutually unbiased, you will have more redundancy.
But for comparison, I would be using only a single basis, not just any set of.
One single basis
of diagonal elements.
So the number of measurements is of the same order you have to do.
That's right.
But this base depends on the state. For every state, you have a different base. And if you're going to...
No,
but then you have to compute of diagonal elements.
Of course, complex number.
But it's of course possible, it's doable, but this scheme gives better results in this case. The errors are somehow optimized in this case.
Yes.
So measuring of diagonal elements is not so easy because you have to do something that it is observable,
And here you have probabilities. Therefore, you don't need, in a sense, to.
Well, in practice, of course, in multidimensional space, you've got a lot of these bases, and it's absolutely not easy. Believe me, it's not easy to define all these observables that pertain to all the vectors of all the bases.
By the way, non-diagonal elements, you also. Calculate from such diagonal observers using sums and
of course.
Just due to polarization of
if this is correct row, of course you can compute anything with that. Yeah. It's only a question of reconstructing row.
Yes, you measure data from which you can reconstruct. But this is the idea of tomography. You measure something,
yes,
and then you want to reconstruct the shape, three-dimensional shape of the body. This is idea of the
yes. Okay, so now let me mention another interesting fact about mutually invasive bases, which is related to entanglement. Entanglement in the case of bipartite systems. So suppose we have two parties, one having a Hilbert space of dimension nA, and another one with Hilbert space of dimension nB. We know that the total amount of entanglement in the maximal set of mutually invasive bases is a constant. Uh-huh. If you sum the entanglement of all the vectors in all the bases of a maximal set, you get a constant. This is not exactly entanglement, but it's a function of entanglement. So this is the trace of the reductions. Uh-huh. This is the square of the reductions in bipartite system. So is a trace related to a list. Uh-huh. We are tracing out both systems. Uh-huh. And if this is a one, we know that the state is pure. And if this is one over the dimension, uh-huh, we know that it's maximally entangled. So it's one-to-one related with a measure of. So this number is a constant, And there is a very interesting result, because if in prime power dimension we construct a maximal set of maps such that a subset is a maximal set of separable mutually invasive bases, then the rest of the bases has to be maximally entangled. So if we ask for too many separable bases, for this conservation law, all the rest of the bases has to be maximally entangled.
What is the total amount of entanglement?
In this sense, is this the sum of all these traces?
Average. You can have vectors which form bases, and you compute average entanglement for entire bases.
Yes, yes.
So
yes.
The total means the average in a sense.
Average.
Yes, it's the average. It's the average. This index sum into the bases, and here we are summing.
So if you have a bipartite system, all elements of the basis can be separable or entangled, or you can compute somehow to what extent they can be entangled. And here's an interesting statement that on average, this average entanglement, defined in this way, is always constant. If you rotate with this basis, which is non-trivial.
So it's not a property of the state, but it's a property
of the set of bases, in fact.
Yes.
Not of a single basis, but entire complicated set of bases.
Yes.
But for instance, it's an important statement, you cannot find separable. You cannot find all those groups containing only separable states,
right,
or only entangled. It's not possible. The average is fixed. Mm-hmm. Which is a result of Polish people together with Chinese people.
And the result behind this proof is that maximal set of mutually invasive bases form a two design.
Design is not art only, but in combinatorics it's something like designs. It's a quantum design. It's an analog of combinatorial designs. Design is, for instance, like magic square, Latin square, all of those are designs in combinatorics. Mm-hmm. There are certain tables of numbers. Mm-hmm. And this is, okay, kind of analogy, but
yes,
then
yes,
we don't
yes
need to go into details.
No, it's
combinatorial design.
It's just a comment. Okay, so now I will show you some new results related to mutually invasive bases. And this is specifically related with the fact that I can introduce free parameters in mutually invasive bases in such a way that these parameters cannot be absorbed in global rotations, and also for any value of the parameters, the map property is not missing. So I will show you one of the results. And one of the most important results is that if I have n real mutually invasive bases in dimension n, then I can construct this parametric set, this number of parametric set of inequivalent mutually invasive bases for any value of these parameters.
Inequivalent with respect to rotations.
In the sense that I cannot connect them with a straightforward rotation, global rotation. So in other way, all these parameters appear in the inner product of the vector of different bases. So they are not related by global rotation.
And these are ordinary rotations because they are real. So these are not unitary.
Yes, this is what I wanted to ask. Is that real spaces or complex?
I start with real mutually invasive bases, but the parameters are introduced in complex spaces. So I cannot have a parametric set of real. All of them are complex. Are only real for when all the parameters are zero.
So you start with real and you go out of the space
of
real.
Yes,
and
yes,
yes. Complex.
So I will not show you exactly the proof of this fact just to mention the results.
But this is, I think that the question of Rinzai-Yonisky is still important, because if it starts real and go to complex, so it means that obviously you cannot obtain anything complex from the real basis by real annotation. So it must be unitary, yes?
So equivalence with respect to unitary.
Unitary,
yes, right. Unitary, of course. So for example, in dimension 4, I can generate a 4-parametric triplet of mutually invasive bases. One of the parameters is linearly dependent. And this is a well-known fact. Some years ago, Stefan Beiger published this result. But this is new. In dimension 16, there are 9 real mutually invasive bases in dimension 16. And I can generate, I can introduce 64 free parameters in a set of 9 real mutually invasive bases.
Why is real more important in quantum mechanics than just?
No. I'm not talking about more important. I mean real here because the construction is a trick. And it works well. When I have real maps, it always works. But there is no restriction to real. It's not valid for a specific, only for real maps. I will show you here that.
So in a sense, we start with real solution, and we want to lift it to yes. Complex, and you find an orbit of solutions
yes.
which go out of real space to complex space.
Yes,
it's
yes,
only
yes.
a starting point, yes?
Okay. Yes, in this orbit, only a single point
is real.
Is real when all the parameters are zero. And
but in general, if you have such a maximal set of this basis, so there is no reason why they all should be. Real.
No, but
and
I
of course
here,
in the simplest example here, already shown.
No,
the basis which is complex.
Yeah.
You cannot find all of them real to have the complete set.
No.
In the case of n equal 2, you have 2 real and that has to be complex.
Yes.
So here the idea is similar. You start with, let's say, 2 real, here 9 real, and you look for the other which are complex.
Yes. No, for example, so real mutually invasive bases exist in dimension 2 or a multiple of 4. And we know that n plus 1 up to, this is an upper bound, n over 2 plus 1 real mutually invasive bases exist when n is a power of 4. But in other cases, this is not true. For example, in dimension 8, we don't have 3, we have only 2. Dimension 8, there are only 3. Only 2 real maps and not 3. But in dimension 16, we have 16 over 2 is 8, plus 1 is 9, so this is a maximal set of real maps, but of course it is not a maximal set of maps, because the maximal set of maps is 17. Okay, so as I mentioned, this method is not restricted only to real maps. So for real maps it's simple, but I can explore another cases. For example, in dimension 8, I can generate 8 parametric sets of 3 mutually invasive bases, 12 parametric sets of 4 mutually invasive bases, and 4 parametric sets, note that here decrease the number of parameters, set of 5 mutually invasive bases, and I couldn't introduce parameters in 6 bases. So apparently, sets of 6 mutually invasive bases are isolated. And reasonable to think that a maxima set of maps is isolated, but here we see that only for six maps we have isolated points. Okay, so now let me apply these results, dimension 8. I will think about dimension 8 as the space of 3 qubits. Uh-huh. And I will study the entanglement properties in the case of 5 mutually invasive bases. So I will play with these 4 parameters. Uh-huh. For simplicity, I will consider that these 4 parameters are equal. And let me consider the first case where, so these are my 5 mutually invasive bases. 3 of them are separable, 2 of them are maximally entangled, and the parameters, the 4 parameters, are introduced here in a separable basis.
That's it. Maximally entangled for 3 qubits is like GHD state?
Yes, yes, yes. They are equivalent to the GHD set state. Every state is equivalent to the, yes, the maximally entangled in the sense of the GHD set.
We need to write it on the blackboard because we
know. Yes.
So, dimension 8.
So, all of the states are equivalent to this one, which is the maximum entangled state.
So it's like 3 qubit equivalent of the famous Bell state. Mm-hmm.
Yes, of course.
And
yes.
GHD.
Realization.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Also in green.
So, for this example, if I move the parameters, I see this is a bit boring case because for any value of the parameters, all the states here in this basis are separable. Uh-huh. So this is a tensor product matrix for all the values of the parameters. But the second case is interesting because I have two separable bases and 3 maximally entangled. Uh-huh. And here something interesting appears because in principle, when the parameter is 0, uh-huh, this basis is separable. Uh-huh. So here we have, where the parameter is 0, this all the traces of this reduction, the square of the reductions, is 1, which means that we have separable state. But when we move the parameter, entanglement between A and C, uh-huh, entanglement between these two parties, goes from 0 to the maximal value. Uh-huh. So this party is always separable. We don't have entanglement here. Uh-huh. We don't have entanglement here. But in these two parties, we can control, by using this parameter, we can control entanglement without losing the property of mutually unbiased. That's the nice thing. These bases are mutually unbiased for any value of the parameter, but we can move the entanglement. Uh-huh. From the separable to the maximum entanglement. Uh-huh.
If I could make a very, very simple comment. Trace of law A square or law C square, just the purity of the partial trace. Now, yes. The purity is 1, you have separable states, and entanglement increases if this parameter decreases. So the function goes down, entanglement goes.
Entanglement, yes.
Which
yes,
is perhaps yes, not intuitive. Yes. So entanglement is the largest if the purity achieves 1/2.
1/2, yes.
Okay. It corresponds to the basic.
And final case is when we consider 1 separable basis and 4 maximally entangled, and now the parameter is introduced in a maximally entangled basis. So for the stand
for the starting value we have maximal entangle, and when we move the parameter, all the parameters, the four parameters, the entanglement doesn't increase. Doesn't decrease. So the slip particles are in the in state equivalent to the CHC state for all the values of the parameter. We have always maximal entangled and the property of Newtonian Bessie spaces. And these are only three cases, but by introducing parameter in different places, even by introducing in different bases, this one or this one, it's possible to generate many different cases. And so we have a lot of freedom to try to play with these entanglement things.
What is the space of these parameters? How do they vary?
They go from zero to pi.
They are phases.
Any value. They
phases.
Phases. There is no restriction on the phase. Okay, so to resume, we present a review of Newtonian Bessie spaces, which have many important applications in quantum mechanics. We can generate Newtonian Bessie spaces having three parameters, and this is new in any dimension higher than four, because in literature there is only case known in dimension four. And we have this nice property about Newtonian Bessie spaces having three parameters plus entanglement control. So this new property probably has interesting applications in quantum information theory. I have no clear yet for what is this useful, but it is surely useful for something. Maybe cryptography, I don't know. I don't know this very clean. So, this is all I wanted to show you today, so thank you very much.
Finishing much, much ahead of time, so we have plenty of time for discussions. So where this picture was taken?
I'm not sure, but...
Entangled tree, yes.
Do you know what this is?
Entangled tree?
This is classical entanglement.
Yes. Any other questions?
I don't know if this is real or not. This is real. I take it from Google. I'm not sure.
I think it's real.
Real.
So it is possible. In principle, it's possible.
Yes, it's wrong.
Wait. Force them to do it.
Long enough. Yes, so it's
worth it. Yes.
But it can also.
Just take a look at the
map. Any other questions? Or comments? Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again. Okay, I'm